Afternoon Truth Wins team today. It's a bright, sunny California day.
We have, very bright.
Right. We had a lot of fun. We went to a puppy rescue and helped some puppies be rescued. We always know that God loves all his animals, big and large, you, me, everybody.
There was even a puppy there that looked like Hollywood. It was her nephew.
Right. So we thought that was pretty fun. But today we'll start off with prayer and then we'll go to our lesson.
Dear Holy Father, we glorify you in everything we do. We thank you, Father, that we praise your holy name. We know that we need to praise you because you inhabit the praises of your family. We thank you, Father, that we glorify you in everything we do. We thank you, Father, that you are a part of this production today. Give us the revelation, the wisdom, the knowledge, and understanding. To us and all the people viewing this, we thank you, Father, that you are our focus in everything we do. We ask this now in the name of Jesus, the name of all names. Amen.
Amen. Well, today we're going to start off with the things you do. The things you do is you pray like Jesus, because Jesus was kind enough to give us an example of how we should pray. So we're going to start off with some of the things we learned from the King himself, Jesus, King Jesus.
In Matthew 6, 9 through 10, after this manner, therefore pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Also in Luke 11, 2, it says, and he said unto them, when we pray, say, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. God promises often, come with conditions. One such condition is having faith in God as the one who can answer our prayers. It is clear that this condition implies the anticipation of actually receiving what we request. The word hallow is a verb, and its meaning is to respect greatly, to praise by showing deep respect for holiness. The term hallowed may not be widely used nowadays, but it carries great significance for Christians. It pertains to the process of being sanctified and made sacred. It is imperative for us to actively incorporate our God into the sacred aspects of our existence. It is crucial to recognize that our God has designated a sacred space for us to dwell upon. Consequently, we should devote our time on this sacred ground to glorify Him.
Right, I think that's like really an important thing. Like you started off in your prayer saying, God inhabits the praises of his people. So if we start off by praising him, saying, glory to God, hallelujah, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Because hallow means holy. And so we need to give honor and respect to God. God does answer our prayers, but he wants to have us come to him not all the time just going, give me, give me, give me, what can you give me? He wants a relationship with you. He's
not against giving you what right. You need and your petition of prayer. But, you know, if you study the Word of God, you'll find in situations with Paul and Silas and other characters or in the Bible, when they got in a situation, they started praying, praising God, giving him glory. it said, and then God showed up. It greases the skid for our blessing to come, because when we praise God, it says he inhabits it.
He's
and
there.
He changes. He's always there, but he more in what I would say.
Well, you're having a relationship with
him. Yeah, you're having a relationship. You're saying hallelujah, meaning it's a Hebrew word meaning glory to God.
Right, it's like with your teenage child. Like, obviously, little kids ask their parents for more because natural human parents know to give good gifts to their children. And it says, but God will even give more. But once your child's grown, you still give to them, but you'd like to have a relationship. You'd like to go out and just fellowship with them, go have lunch with them, talk about God.
Have a relationship. And like, that's what God wants to have with us.
Right, because Randy just had a birthday and we went out with his brother to a restaurant. His brother took him out for his birthday and we spent 5 hours at the restaurant because we were there at lunch and then lunch kind of fades away. And then
we were the only people in the restaurant.
Right. We noticed that the dinner crowd was beginning to come and thought, well, we need to leave so that they can have space. But we just talked about the Bible and how great God is, and it was a really good time. And you learn what's up in their life and what you could pray for them. And yeah, it's just a nice time. So God's the same thing. He says, "Our Father." That's what Jesus is saying.
Yeah, we're made in His likeness. So therefore, you could see the things that we have this inner being that we like certain things. Well, God has that same inner being in Himself. And he wants to be a part of our lives,
right.
Not just in granting us according to his word,
our needs,
but also in our needs.
Yeah.
But also he wants to have a relationship, like sitting in a restaurant with your brother. He's like sitting in the restaurant with my father, you know.
And he wants us to praise him and thank him and just say, oh, look at the beautiful sunset you made. It's gorgeous. You did such a good
praise
job.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, praise the Lord. So I think, first of all, he said, our Father. So he wants you to know, yes, this is a respect thing. He's your Father. And hallowed be thy name. You're holy. So we need to praise
him. Great is your name.
And then the next part is, I always like this part. When I did Bible study fellowship, because we did Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it's kind of interesting to know. One says, as in heaven, so on earth. And the other says, so in heaven, so on earth. So one side saying, as in heaven, so on earth. The other saying, as in on earth, so in heaven. So heaven and earth are to be the same. Once Jesus died, we're redeemed from the curse. And basically, we're living in heaven and earth when we do the conditions to the promises.
Right.
Right. They are conditional. It's not a magic genie.
It's not just magic genie or Midas touch.
Because everybody wants to do just ask what you will and it'll be so. But it says abide in me and I in you and you can ask what you will. Because you're
first
listening.
First the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
Right. Because then God's telling you what to seek. You're asking him for guidance and he's giving you guidance. And there's conditions, but let's go on and see what else there is.
Well,
to
his
say.
Guidance is also in the Word of God, but also I always want to emphasize that you hear the voice of God, the Holy Spirit, the how do you say, Rock Hakadesh
is the
is Holy Spirit
person.
In Hebrew. I think I said it right. Anyway,
so we'll go on to our next scripture.
It says in James 4:3. We ask and we receive not, because we ask amiss, that we may consume it upon your lust. In 1 John 3:21-22, beloved, if our heart condemns us not, then have we confidence towards God. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight.
Right, so there's one of the conditions. You need to do things pleasing in his sight. So what could be a pleasing thing in his sight? How about this? We bring our tithes into the storehouse to prove him. And
right.
then once we've done that, what happens? The condition he fulfills. What does he do?
He multiplies it. He blesses
it. Right. He says, I open the windows of heaven
and open up
and pour out more blessings than you have
to hold it all.
right, more than you have room to say, or give and it shall be given unto you. So
not only that, it came to me that when Jesus was showing up with the original few disciples that were the disciples of John the Baptist, Bartholomew said to his cousin, I think it was, what could come out of Nazareth? But when he met Jesus, he realized that this was the Messiah, and Jesus said, I called Bartholomew a man without gall. In other words, without any bad sayings, even though he had said something about his hometown. But what I'm trying to say, we need to keep our mind on the positive side, our spirit on the positive side when we say, talk about things. Right. Because if we're running around saying, well, that's bad, and this is bad, and that's bad, and talking and whining. That's
bad seeds to plant. We're going to plant good seeds. Right. Because as our title said, things you do, and that's not things that anybody watching this does. They always do the right thing.
He called Bartholomew a man without guile, without any problem. When really, if you saw, you heard, read what it was, is Bartholomew had a bad mouth, basically.
But he learned and changed. So we're going to stick
on. So Jesus was calling that which he wanted in Bartholomew.
Right, because that's what we do. Because this is all about what we do. When we go to pray to God, we think of him as our Father. We
forgive.
But not just that. We're going back to the Lord's Prayer. First, we acknowledge him as our Father. Then we give him praise. Hallowed be thy name. And then we realize his kingdom has come here. And so we know what heaven's like. So we know he answers our prayers. And right. Then when we go to ask, we also have to not just be asking. The purpose of God giving us things is to build his kingdom, not to build our lust. So we're not going to do our lust. So we'll go on and see what else we're not doing. Right. But if we're doing what we should, then we know he's supplying our needs.
Seek first the kingdom of God.
Right. So we'll go to the next one.
It says in Proverbs 28:13, he that covereth his sins shall not prosper. But whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. First Timothy 2:8. I will therefore that man pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath or doubting.
Right. So we go to this. That gives us another condition. He wants us to lift up our holy hands in praise.
Most people used to, I remember in my early days, nobody did that. When I went to church, I went to church early. I mean, my parents were from the South, and they went to the local church that many people in the South went to of that type. And it was like you could drop a pin on the floor.
Yeah, but they love God, and many people were saved. God. So that's not
but
really
I didn't
the issue.
See, but toward the end of my time,
people began to lift their hands again.
People started raising their hands because the Holy Spirit was interacting in their hearts, and they wanted to praise the Lord.
Right, and the big part is you're not having wrath, because that's one of the requirements. If you have, when you go to bring your offering, if there's a problem with a brother, you go ask for forgiveness. So that's another condition we have to meet.
Right.
So there's lots of conditions, but they're very easy to meet. But if you're wondering why your prayer might not be answered, it's because you're going to switch and you are doing these things. You're doing what you need to do to make it happen. So we'll go on to.
It says to have mercy.
Right, God will have mercy on you if you're really with a pure heart. If you make a mistake, God wants you to win. He's not here like trying to squish a bug. He wants you to win, so he'll have mercy and put someone in your path who can teach you, or the Holy Spirit will tell you.
Right.
Or you'll read it in the Bible and you'll just progress. So we'll go on to another scripture that tells us what to do.
This is Romans 8:26-27. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God.
Right, and so that's another great condition that we have that we can use. We can have the Holy Spirit and speak in tongues.
Right.
It's a key.
Most people don't understand the real, really, when you speak in tongues, it's really praising God. So it's helping us being in the relationship with God.
And getting where
we're
going.
And I always call
the
speaking in tongues as our supercharge.
Right.
Because, so, you know, you can pray in English and praise God in English, but you run out of, you having to repeat a whole lot in order to do it. But then when you're speaking in tongues, you have no limitation. The Holy Spirit's bringing it up in you, and you are continuing. You could go for hours and hours speaking in tongues and not have a thought of anxiety because you're running out of things to say.
Right. So today I went out and I was praying. I'm praying because Vacation Bible School's coming. I'm praying for the leaders and the teachers. And God, there's someone there that's at the church too doing some of the things you have to do to get ready. And he's setting up. And God says, go talk to him about speaking in tongues. And I'm thinking, well, I don't really know him very well. And I'm thinking, well, I don't know if I really want to do that, and although I really want to always do what God wants me to do. But I'm there with Hollywood, and I'm throwing her ball. And then the man across the street comes, who I know with his dog, Bodie, and he starts playing. So I'm thinking, well, okay, well, how am I going to do this with this other man and this man here? And so I'm thinking, oh, well, and the dogs kind of play, and then it's time to go, and Randy's talking to this other man, and God goes, well, you need to talk to him. And I'm going, okay, I will. So I go up to him and I say, well, you know, have you ever thought of speaking in tongues? And he goes, well, he says, I've heard of it. And he goes, but you know, the prime thing is really that everybody get born again. And I go, well, that is the prime thing. Everybody needs to be born again. But I said, you know, go to home and read your Bible in Mark 16, chapter 15 through 18. Jesus tells us what we should be doing. So all of you should read it too. Right. And part of it is speaking in tongues, because the Holy Spirit helps us to draw near to God, to guide us, and instruct us.
We're God's representative on earth. He's a spirit in heaven. He and we have the power here on earth.
Right. So So I figured He had heard of tongues. He'd gone to a church prior to this church that had that in it. And so someone probably's talked to him. So I figure it's kind of like Paul planted, I'm now watering, and God will give the increase. The next thing I know, he'll be speaking in tongues. Yeah.
Well, yeah, and I was telling him that I was at my chiropractor, and we were talking, you know, we were just casually talking about things. And she's a Christian and all that, but we somehow got onto tongues a little bit. She goes, well, I want to speak in tongues. I said, well, you can speak in tongues. We can do
it's
it right now.
It's a free gift, just like salvation.
And
yeah.
All of a sudden, I spoke in tongues a little. And
she asked and to be filled up by the Father.
Yeah, and she just asked.
Father,
I said,
fill me
all you
up.
Do is ask. Yeah. It's nothing, you know, elaborate here. And you just kind of let it, you allow it to come up out of you. And you kind of, you have to
speak.
Make an effort. You
right.
got to speak it,
right.
And it makes, and you, when you do it, when you make an effort, the Holy Spirit's right behind you.
And it just wells up and
she started speaking in tongues, and she's, you
amazed
know,
how easy it was.
She was kind of amazed.
How easy it was.
I said, well, then you need to practice it. You need
right.
to do it all the time.
Right.
You don't just do it one time and then, you know.
That's enough. So
that's enough. So
that
but was, it was great.
Was
she was
fun.
Happy.
So
she was going, whoa.
We're encouraging you all to do it too. Go out. Follow what Jesus' command was for us.
Yeah, his command in Mark 16, 15 through 18. First thing it says, they will speak with new tongues.
Right, they'll lay hands on the sick and they'll recover.
Right.
No poison will hurt them.
We have that mandate from Jesus just before he left. That's what he said.
And then he went to heaven.
And
right.
he went to heaven. He said, well, I'm passing it to you guys. Well, get her done.
And so what we're going to do, the book this week is for those of you who don't believe in Jesus. It's the Rabbi from Burbank. It's a great book.
Right.
The Rabbi from Burbank set out, well, Randy will read some of it and tell you more, but I have to tell you, because I probably read the book the most, was the Rabbi, because he was a rabbi, was sure Jesus wasn't the Messiah, so he set out to prove that he wasn't.
Yeah. Yeah,
and instead...
A little back.
He proved he was. So what I would say is, whatever religion you are, go out and try to prove Jesus isn't who he is. But
right.
If you think about it, like our calendar, even our calendar that we live with in America, is based on Jesus's birth. There's so much around Jesus's birth.
Yeah, it's
he
so,
changed the world.
Yeah, and the Bible is 100% true.
Right.
Every time.
And so he's going to tell you about this.
Well,
book.
I was going to give you a little more detail here. So this Rabbi Zwirn, he was a rabbi. His father was a rabbi. His grandfather was a rabbi, I believe. And they were Orthodox Jews. It wasn't just casual Jews, but they were Jews. I would say it that way. And his life was,
And he had a Jewish wife, and his children were Jewish.
Jew,
so his whole family, everything
Jewish.
About him was Jewish.
They were 100% Jewish. Let's say it that way. They did all the ritual or the culture of the Jewish.
The Passover and all those things.
Yeah, and the Passover.
And Purim. And
Purim and all of them. There's
Hanukkah,
seven of them, I believe this. But anyway, he started asking questions with other rabbis. And they said, well, you don't want to get into that. You know, you don't want to learn who the Messiah really is. You know, we just want to leave that
alone.
We just
know he's not who he said, so
we're
just not going to bother.
You know, they kind
why
of brush
waste time?
Over it. Like,
let's not waste time on
it. But he was, I guess it was the Holy Spirit. He didn't know it, but the Holy Spirit. And they named him the Zionist Rabbi because he was going to prove who is the Messiah. Who is the Messiah? And he went through like years, and he started classes as a Zionist rabbi, and he lived in Burbank, California, and he continued, and he only did the Torah, the five books of the Bible, and he studied it, and then he went to the prophets, and he said, when he got to Isaiah, he didn't really know anything about Jesus. You know, he didn't study anything about the Christian faith. He really didn't know anything about the Christian faith. But in Isaiah, he said that was the
eye-opener.
Epiphany that he's going. It's amazing that all these prophecies and all that Isaiah was that it's pointing to the Messiah, Jesus. He calls him Jesus, Yeshua, Messiah. Jesus the Messiah.
Okay.
And it was like, whoa.
Okay.
And then he started talking to his family, and his family, they kind of rejected him. Everybody rejected him. They said,
so what, there's a page. Don't want to skip one.
Well, anyway,
okay, so what
I came to the 13th chapter here, and it's a very good chapter. It says, why did, you know, because he continued after he got kind of rejected. Why did God give Abraham such a good deal? And so he was continued to say, it says here, up until including the time of Abraham lived, the whole earth lived by what might be called morality of the jungle. Might is right. In other words, the survival of the fittest, as Darwin said. So anyway, later on, he continued to study all that, and he finally concluded the conclusion he had, and I'll read it right here, the last paragraph in the book, basically. God made a good deal with Abraham that has extended to all of his children. In other words, he's saying not only the Jews, but the Gentiles, as they would say, or the Goyim. And it is spelled out in God's communication with Abraham and confirmed throughout both the Old and the New Covenant. He called them both the Old and the New Covenant. And it says, bless yourself, God said to Abraham and to all his obedient children, I will bless you and be a blessing to yourselves and to all those around you. And I will bless you with my shalom, my total comprehensive peace, happiness, health, and prosperity. And he goes, that can't be more less than a super good deal, he said. That was his conclusive statement. And really...
Right, and he became a Christian.
Yeah, well, let's say it this way. He didn't give up his Judaism. He still was a Jew. And he said, I am a Jew, but I am a Messianic Jew. He didn't go to a Christian church. He didn't become, you know, dump the Judaism and totally become a Christian. He still stayed a Jew. He was a Jew that believed that Yeshua, Messiah, was the Messiah. And he's a great man. Well, he's passed away now. But anyway, his family is a great, because they continued to as well. There are bodies of other Jewish Jews that believe that Yeshua is the Messiah. And right. There is congregations in Burbank today.
Right, and it's true of any religion. If you're a Buddhist, don't go by someone's writing who's condemning it. Like, that's one thing he did. He actually just went and read the Bible for himself and let God speak to his heart. As opposed to, because a lot of times, like historians, one writes wrong and then the other one keeps saying wrong, yeah, and wrong and wrong.
Commentary isn't always true.
Go to the source, not people. Go to the word. If it's in the word, believe it. If it's not in the word, and if it needs to be in the word more than once, because obviously the favorite one is Judas hung himself, and we're not supposed to all go hang ourselves.
Yeah, well, you know, corrupt the Bible by adding things in there that doesn't exist.
Well, one of the things I was also thinking of, I used to belong to a mastermind group for business. It was run by Brian Buffini. It was a great thing. And part of the time when we met, we would be told great books to read, like we read How to Win Friends and Influence People, What You Say When You Talk to Yourself by Chad Helmstetter, Who Moved My Cheese, something of Babylon,
Rich Man in Babylon.
The Richest Man in Babylon. But one of the speakers who came said, well, because we're all told in this mastermind group to get this book, we meet once a month, read the book, learn from the book. And his comment was, well, yes, it's good you read the book, because we all had read the book, but you need to put the book into practice. So it's great you listen to us. Well, we thank you. We think there's people around the world. We thank you. It's kind of like when you go to church. You go to church, you're there. The preacher maybe preaches a half hour.
He's just giving you a tidbit. But you need to study.
It's not you need to study. You need to go implement it. And so I found, here's the business world going. Here we have this great book. It's telling you, like the 1 minute manager, how to manage your workers. Now go home and do it. Don't just read it and go, okay.
Well,
we've read this book. We're going
to
go put it on the shelf and forget about it. So I would say you can get lots of things online, PDFs for free. You can go to your library. You can buy Audibles. You can do Kindles. You can go to Barnes & Noble and buy books. Yeah, so there's no excuse for not doing it. You probably can go on YouTube and listen to book stories. But then you need to implement it into your life. That's the key. We're all learning. Because remember, the topic of this is what I'm doing. What you're doing is you're following the conditions that are required. So when you pray, your prayers are immediately answered. So you're walking in love. If you have aught against a brother, you go ask and get it settled and you forgive. You believe it's God's will. His word is his will. It says he heals. We never see a time when Jesus sent someone away and said, not today. God wants you sick. I'm going to pray you sicker. We never see that. So we need to know it's God's will to heal us, because that's what he says in Mark. Go lay hands on the sick and they'll recover.
Right. Right. And if you drink anything poison or you're jabbed by anything, it will not hurt you.
Right.
Yeah.
Right? Because like the other day...
you need to study to make yourself prosperous. It's right. really what it is. God's word never falls to the ground. It's like in archaeology. The archaeology, you know, they found Abraham's down in Hebron, near Hebron in the Genesis. It talks about him being in the grove with the big trees and that kind of thing. And they have 4,000 years ago, he built an altar, and they found the remnants of that altar and the buildings that were there at that time, 4,000 years ago.
Right, and so we have shown you walking through the Red Sea, the remains of the chariot that are under the Red Sea. So there's historical proof. There's people, testimonies of people who are still healed today. We told you about the monks long ago in Ireland who raised the dead. So it's not just in Jesus' time. So you need, and you do, not just you need, you do study, and you're walking in love, and you're learning, and you're having answers to your prayer because you do it.
Right.
You can and you do.
That's why it says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things, all these things will be added unto you.
Even there, I love it. I was walking around because school's not in, so I walk around and I'm praying for the students at the junior high near where we live, and I'm looking at the wall because they have some murals that the students or maybe parents painted, and one of them says, if you believe you can, you're halfway there. And it was by Teddy Roosevelt. And
right, I thought, Teddy Roosevelt
said
that.
Yes, I can. I can do this. So
right.
My great-grandfather always said, those who think they can and those who think they can't are both right.
Yeah, and your great-grandfather knew Teddy Roosevelt.
Right. Know that I can. So be the one who chooses I can. So I remember doing a speech for a high school down in the San Fernando Valley for the graduating seniors. And that was my thing to them. You're right if you say you can, and you're right if you say you can't, because if you say that enough, you won't. But if you say you can, you're graduating from high school, you can be anything. You can, it doesn't matter, like time will pass. If you go to college, let's say, and you could get out in 4 years, if it takes you 8 years, time is passing, but in 8 years you'll be there and you'll be smarter and wiser. So if you, the first time I read the Bible, I set the goal. I read the left side of the page and then the right side, turned the page and put the bookmark. Well, you know what? Guess what happens?
It permeates your being.
Well, it does, but you finish it.
Yeah,
like
that's
people
true.
Go, oh, the book's so hard and so long. Hey,
scripture
the time
that comes to me is Galatians 4:13, I think it is. I can do all things through Christ that strengtheneth me. So with his prompting to you, you have a good, a plan through God involving in your life. You have a good plan, you'll be a success. You can't not be a success with God.
Right. So what we'd like you to end with is that one of the things Jesus taught you was to praise God. It says, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy
hallowed.
Name.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hallowed be his name. So I happen to like a song by Hezekiah Walker.
Hezekiah Walker.
And it's on YouTube. You can listen to it. But what I'm encouraging you to do, we're going to just leave you with that when we go to click off. You can listen to the whole thing. It's kind of just well, I think they planned it, but it just looks like...
It looks like spontaneous...
It's not combustion.
What do they call that when they all...
When they all just... just happens. But I'm sure they did plan it, but you can go to YouTube and just find a song yourself. Give it a thumbs up and you like it. But I like just standing and singing and praising it at home in my house. Like, just praise God for all he's done. Every praise is to God. And so we're going to do that. I think we're on chapter 17 and Not Alone. We'll go up this Thursday, and we'll be up. This will be posted this Wednesday. And anything else you want to say?
God is absolutely
good.
Yes,
we always have to do this. Truth. No, it should be truth first and wins. And yes, it's good. See, the hard part is it's truth wins because it's backwards, but then it makes the book...
It's not backwards when you...
Well, but it's for me because I usually would do it this way, but hey, whatever. So we're going to flip off to our song and we'll see you next week, and we know you're doing it because you can. Oops, if I can get my thing to flip. Oops.
Every praise
is to our God.